This is The Close-Up, conversations about creativity. From our studios in Los Angeles, here is Jim Chabon.
Guy Primus is with us. He is the co-founder and CEO of the virtual reality company here in Hollywood. His team is working with directors Steven Spielberg and Robert Stromberg to create premium story-driven VR content. Before that, he ran Overbrook Entertainment, a production company founded by actor Will Smith and producer James Lasseter. He also serves on the Board of Governors of the Advanced Imaging and VR Societies here in Hollywood. Welcome, Guy.
Appreciate it, Jim. How's everything?
It's pretty exciting time in our industry, isn't it?
Absolutely.
You've probably seen more VR than most. What was your aha moment? When were you, what were you looking at when you put the headset down and said, you know, this is exciting?
Yeah, I could tell you exactly where I was. I was in kind of the screening room at the third floor, which is one of our sister companies. But I'm sitting in a screening room and they put the headset on me, and I was watching a short film that Robert Stromberg, you know, my co-founder and the chief creative officer of VRC, had produced. It was called There. And it was really kind of the look inside of a woman's dreams and actually going back in her childhood and actually seeing some of the objects that were really important to her. And you're on this really mystical, magical journey. And I just remember sitting there and just, you know, being amazed.
Talk a little bit about how you see storytelling in VR.
You know, when you're looking at virtual reality, you know, and you look at, you know, kind of traditional media, television and film, you're always looking into a frame. Virtual reality is more like the theatrical experience, you know, kind of the going to a Broadway play, because you're able to focus on different things on a larger stage. Our stage just happens to be spherical and, you know, kind of 360 degrees and, you know, a lot more kind of depth of field. But, you know, that's kind of, we look at how you tell a story on the theater stage. And, you know, there are things and different ways of kind of focusing people's attention, different ways of kind of conveying emotion. And it's a little bit, it does take a little bit of control out of the hands of the director, but really that just makes you be a little bit more perfect about the stories. And, you know, people can find different stories from different characters, and that's what VR really provides for.
The Martian, which is a kind of a part of your company's story, Robert Stromberg, director, was very involved in creating this amazing experience, which I think most people say right now it's kind of the standard that we all look at and measure VR by, mm-hmm. about a 30-minute experience.
Right.
Do you have a sense in your mind of what the sweet spot is about how long these can be or should be when we think in terms of creating content for VR?
Yeah, I think there are a number of ways to look at it. One is kind of how good is the content. I think if you're creating a great piece of content, if it's something that really moves people, they kind of lose themselves and they don't really think about the fact that they have this head-mounted display on their head, or, you know, they have a cord kind of dangling from the back of their head. So I think really, if you can tell a great story, the time is not so relevant. But I think really the technology is an issue, and so I think what we try to kind of aim for is a sweet spot of, you know, anywhere from kind of 5 minutes on the shorter side to, you know, around 30 minutes on the longer side. And we will kind of tell longer stories, but in an episodic format. So we'll tell, you know, maybe 10 to 20 minutes at a time and hope to tell a longer story in a more episodic way.
People involved in your company include Steven Spielberg and Robert Stromberg, who between the two of them have 5 Oscars. So you're surrounded by among the most brilliant minds in content today. Do you think that VR storytelling or VR as a medium is best placed in the hands of people who understand the other platforms? That those are the people that are going to help us deliver something that families in the Midwest will want to get for Christmas?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. And you know, one thing I took away from my time at Overbrook Entertainment was kind of this focus on universally relatable emotion. And so we have this ability to tell any story in the world, but right now we really want to tell stories that are relevant to people. We, you know, that you know, kind of are relatable to you know, anywhere from kids 8 to 80. And so I think that's one thing that we really focus on and is really critical is kind of telling the right story and telling it in the right way.
If you could get the whole industry in the room, and we're going to on October 13th and 14th at Paramount Studios, from the technology people to the creative people, what is the conversation that you think would be most helpful in helping us all get to where we want to go with this being a real business?
Yeah, I think It's a moonshot. It is kind of us all organizing around a common goal and you know, kind of the release of some product or the achievement of some objective, and then just getting the best and brightest minds in a room and kind of collaborating on achieving that one objective. And I think that's what the AIS and the VR Society are really geared toward doing, which is why we were so excited to kind of collaborate and kind of become members of the organization. But I think, you know, having that goal that everyone is kind of, you know, striving toward, you know, everyone kind of scattering in their own direction, will create some really good stuff, but I think we don't really kind of achieve monumental success until everyone is kind of rowing in the same direction.
Right. Well, at the end of the day, the consumer who's going to be looking at this is going to be comparing it to video games, the movie that they just took their family to, and they're going to make the determination whether this is something that they think is at the level of the content that they're used to consuming. So I think we all have a pretty high bar.
Absolutely.
That we've got to shoot for. And your sense is that the technology is moving quickly enough, but it needs to move. It needs to continue to improve in order to handle the ever increasing demands that the creative teams are going to have for saying, "Look, this is what I need in order to do something that we're all proud of."
Yeah, absolutely. And so the technology has to continue to evolve, but also the investment has to continue to be made. You know, on the hardware side, on the software side, but you know, more importantly, on the content side. It's very easy for a studio to write a check for $100 million these days because they know how to monetize that. They know the business model. And I think that's one of the challenges is that no one's going to right now write a $100 million check to do a seminal VR project. And so what we're trying to do is kind of do shorter form projects, but do them in an excellent manner so that we can use that as a proof of concept to attract more investment, to attract more investment in the technology, in the software, and then in the content.
Well, we know that there are a few things that Hollywood is very, very good at, and that includes, among other things, is not only creating a content for different kinds of platforms, but marketing and promoting it to a worldwide global audience. So when you think if we can get the content right, the expertise in Hollywood is so good that reaching a wider audience is going to be something that we know how to do. How do we get those to the consumers? How will we find those?
Well, I think a lot of the platforms, whether it's kind of the tethered headsets, you know, Sony PlayStation VR will have their distribution platform. And again, you have 40 million, you know, user base. So when you kind of put a VR headset on any fraction of those people, they already have billing relationships. They already are used to consuming content, whether it's games or video content. So they're very familiar. The same thing with the Vive and kind of the Steam store. You know, so you go there and there are people that are used to consuming games, they're used to downloading, they have accounts, they have billing relationships. And so, you know, that kind of pipeline is well established. What I think is really critical, though, is kind of for us to kind of connect the dots. So the theatrical experience, there will be a kind of destination, location-based VR experiences that are created. But how do you connect the dots between those experiences and the home-based experiences and then the mobile experiences and just make them kind of all seamlessly work together so that people have the incentive to consume content just like they do now in the kind of traditional theatrical windows and then home video windows and, you know, video on demand.
How do we get at pricing an experience? What are the models being kicked around? How do you see that?
Well, I mean, I think a lot of this goes back to kind of A/B testing and just making sure that you kind of make some investment, you mitigate risk on the downside, but then you kind of, you're just willing to experiment. No one really knows what this stuff is going to cost. There's not this kind of industry consortium that's going to agree that, just like they did with the CD or with the DVD, that this is the price point that we're going to charge. These experiences are vastly different. They're recorded differently, they're produced differently, they're distributed differently, they have different levels of interactivity. And so I think that we're going to kind of, life will find a way and we'll kind of land upon a pricing structure that works. But I think right now everyone's operating by gut feel.
Our friends at Marvel will say that the opening weekend for Captain America or most Marvel movies, 45 to 50% of the tickets sold are in premium formats. They are in either 3D or 3D IMAX.
Right.
These are the best customers the studio has because they're super fans of the franchise and they want to see it the best, most premium way. Do you see these things being associated with theatrical films to begin with? Or where are we going to see this first and hear about it?
Yeah, so I think the first step is association with brands, whether they're theatrical films or they're sports franchises or musicians that have huge fan bases. And I think that's the first stop, because as you're bringing these things to market, it's really important to be able to monetize and be able to kind of market them effectively. And right now, even though Hollywood is great at marketing, there's no definitive way to market a VR experience. So I definitely think that association with films like The Suicide Squad and Marvel and DC are really going to be critical as we move forward.
How do you see VR impacting our lives 5 years from today, 10 years from today? Is this going to be something that's everywhere? Is it everything? Is it a niche play? How do you look at it?
So I look at it as, there's going to be a continuum. It will be everywhere. VR will be ubiquitous, as it is, honestly, it is right now. So, there will be everything from mobile phones, which everyone has in their pocket, and you can buy a $10 headset or a $5 headset in Google Cardboard, and Google, through their Daydream platform, is actually expanding that, so it'll be more of a premium experience. So there will be everything from that to, we partner with a company called D-Box, which does motion control chairs.
Right.
And again, to your point of making this more immersive and more engaging and more interactive, it actually elevates and gives you that kind of super premium experience.
You've announced a partnership and a project with Steven Spielberg, and I'll get the words right, an original family-oriented VR program. Is your sense that there is a market for VR for something that the whole family would enjoy?
Absolutely. And I wouldn't have necessarily, when in my younger years, and my son's going through this right now, cartoons are for kids. E.T. is, kind of for a younger audience. But, that type of experience, when you see kind of something that does resonate with the whole family, whether it's a Pixar film or a film like E.T. or Frozen, the entire family can enjoy it. And those type of stories can absolutely be told in VR. And not only can they be told in VR, they can be made more immersive in VR.
There's a book, Ready Player One, which Steven Spielberg is making into a movie. The protagonist in this called his refuge of going into the Oasis, into his VR helmet, as his fortress of solitude. He said, "It's where I attended school, did my homework, read books, watched video games. It was where I conducted my ongoing quest to find Halliday's Easter egg." Is VR's future a place where if you want to go to school, you want to travel, that VR really has the potential to deliver on that, on those promises?
No question. I mean, it democratizes experience. And I think, again, just the bandwidth, the screen resolution, all the technology that VR depends on is actually, it exists. It will continue to get better, but, not everyone can afford to hop on a jet and fly overseas to experience the Taj Mahal. It just doesn't happen. It's remote, it's difficult to get to, it's super expensive. But imagine kind of giving every school child or schoolgoer across the around the world that experience, and just by putting on a headset and by using the mobile phone that's in their pocket. So that's, I think it is where people will go to escape. It's a place where people will go to learn, experience new things, to really create and collaborate. I think that's one of the things that is next, is social VR experiences. And I think that as we continue to move forward, Ready Player One kind of is the Bible right now. It's kind of the guidepost that a lot of people are following, and you refer to the Oasis. I think that that's something that that book has set the bar really, really high.
Yeah.
But I think that even in 10 years, that will kind of pale in comparison to actually what people were able to create.
Well, I love the foreword to this book. The dedication says, "Because there is no map for where we are going." Right?
Right.
So we're going to have to figure this out. I was with a friend in a hospital. She's recovering from an illness, and it's noisy, and there's the clattering of trays in the hallway. Mm-hmm. And if you're recovering from something, an illness, an older person, the idea of being able to put on a set of headphones and some VR visors and somehow remove yourself from the tedious boredom of sitting in a hospital.
Absolutely.
It seems like the promise for this is so big. And it doesn't seem like hype somehow. It seems like this could really be something that changes all of our lives.
Right. I mean, again, I've experienced it. And my first experience and subsequent experiences have been fantastic and have been kind of entertainment-based. But that same experience can be and will be kind of made available to everyone around around the globe. And, you know, whether it, again, is something to take your mind away from a dystopian situation like is kind of outlined in Ready Player One, or it's, you know, kind of to elevate your learning, it's possible in VR.
You've been around a lot of directors. Mm-hmm. When you watch these kinds of creative people taking on a project, what do they all have in common that you, when you walk away from a meeting, you know you're with someone who's great at what they do?
Right. They're able to take a picture, an image, and actually tell the story from that image. You know, so they have a picture in their mind of what something is supposed to be and what it's supposed to look like. And so, you know, they're actually driving towards something. They have a creative vision. And it's not just kind of they're hoping to assemble something and have it become great. They have greatness in their mind, and they're actually just looking to bring that to life.
You've hired a lot of people. When you go to hire someone and someone comes in and impresses you in a job interview, what do you look for that that makes you say, okay, I think I'm going to give this person a chance to work with me?
Yeah, I think the first thing is probably passion, especially in a space like this. There are a lot of people that are kind of clamoring to get into the space, but, you know, it's mostly because it's new. They don't really have the passion for storytelling or the passion for visualization or creating an experience. It's people that want to tell a story, people that want to take you someplace, you know, and having the passion for that that's the first thing. I would say the second thing that, you know, people really, it's really important to have is just the ability to kind of work collaboratively. None of this stuff happens, you know, kind of in a vacuum. It all happens through the hard work of the cinematographer, through the director, through the, you know, kind of the VFX supervisor that's putting all this stuff together, through the storyteller who's actually looking to tell a story in a 360-degree sphere. It really needs to be a collaborative process. And while there are people that are talented enough to tell that story alone, I think the best stories will be told collaboratively.
The virtual reality company is the most watched, one of the most watched companies in this town because the people involved with it, including yourself, are so respected and well-regarded, and that you are, in a collaborative way, trying to bring this industry's promise to fruition. So I wish you all the best. I ask you to come back and fill us in. I know you've got a lot of things you probably can't talk about, but maybe next time you'll have a couple of new things that we can share. And just thanks for being here, and good luck.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much.
The Close-Up is produced by the Advanced Imaging and VR Societies in Hollywood and is powered by Barcode.